Yakei Sitini Cheshakat Yuhan. Kasank Yuhatuasak, Le Kahenach, Andrew Williams Yuhatuasak. Akna Hatsati, Kagwantan, Eahat, Takpain Tan Yadi. Akhtasayi Jishkat Daka. My name is Kasank. My English name is Andrew Williams. I am a Kagwantan and a child of the Takpain Tan. I'd like to give special thanks to the people of Sitka for allowing us to host this this clan conference here, and I would also like to give special thanks to UAS for giving us the opportunity to have these workshops and these activities around our culture and our language. So today, I would like to basically demonstrate and show how we can organize data that we have about the language and basically make a place where we can organize ourselves when we start to build digital fires, if you will, around our language. If we come to a new area and we're brand new to the area, even if we know how to make a fire, we have to go out and explore the woods and try to find the materials we need to build a fire. So we'll have to go find a place where there's small sticks. We'll have to go find a place where there's medium sticks. We'll have to go find a place where there's large lumber. We'll have to find some place where we have to have moss. And then you throw in a few other things, like we're in Sitka, so you better plan to know where there's going to be dry versions of this stuff, even in wet weather. So the same thing is true for the Thinkit language and the way that we start to build these digital applications and these digital resources that we have. If we come to a new area, as a person that lives in this area, I should say, we can build a fire. Our uncles teach us how to build this fire, and we can build it. After a time, we know exactly where to go get the resources. We know exactly what to do to build this fire. But if we ever have somebody else come into town, at first, the best thing they're going to be able to do is enjoy the fire that you've built. They won't know how to build one by themselves until you teach them. So a lot of these resources that we have out there today, they are really awesome resources, but they're really a lot like coming to a place where someone has learned to build a fire there, and then you trying to learn how to build a fire with their resources. It's not as easily transferable until they teach you. So when we think about digital technology, it's a lot like sharing this knowledge of where the resources are at. And if you work at making these knowledge resources organized, then when it comes time to build your own fire, then you can build it very easily. And in this metaphorical context, the fire are these applications that we have built to help the language learners. We have a lot of paper resources, but recently there's been a lot of digital products that have been stood up. And like I said, they're really awesome products. They make people excited about the language. The only thing is they're not like an open source thing. So you can enjoy them, but you can't make anything out of them themselves. So I saw this latest dictionary that Hagi Shawu had built, Carrie Eggleston, utilizing material that she's worked with several of the elders of the community. I actually had an opportunity to spend some time listening to her work with the elders, Kakwan Ij, Yakutlat, Kakasat, Kushtaka Ij, Kushtahu Ij, Kushtahu Ij, sorry, Bill Fawcett, and Kakwan Ij, George Davis. And she built this this dictionary that is here. It's her Thinkit Verb Dictionary. It's online. It's a really awesome resource. It's awesome in the sense that it's simplistic in the way that it was built, and it's publicly available. So if you can research it by picking these particular verbs and then hitting that yellow bar, and you can see different forms of the verbs. Really awesome work. And if you look at, it's also got a Thinkit version. If you look at the back source of it, Sometimes it takes a little time to load. The whole page is loaded on there, onto one HTML page. And it converts to about 150,000, 160,000 lines of code. So it's a lot of code for a browser to have to work through. So sometimes it's slow. The beauty of it is everything that you need to access and utilize this resource is on one page. So if you open up the browser, keep it open, never close it, you don't have to have internet connection to get there. The non-view side of it, okay, here it is, yeah. So it's a huge file, but it's really awesome because it's all there. Like 142,000 lines of code. The beauty of it is that it's all there, and it provides an open resource for us to be able to gather this information from. And because it's all organized in this XML file style, it makes it easier for someone who wants to try to glean words and information from it and put it into their own application. So basically, that's what I did here. What I did is I created an object model that is designed for the theme of the Thinkit verb. So most learners that don't have access to a fluent first-born speaker, they have to go to these resources in order to learn. And there's a lot of them out there, so we're really lucky. I talked to other people that were learning 20 years ago, and they say we're spoiled because we got so many resources now. But, you know, I see a lot of these things starting to happen where we're putting up these applications, and it seems like we keep recreating the wheel every time. And so this data object model basically is the equivalent of creating a map for the forest for where we want to gather resources to build a fire. So all of our resources can be organized in this way. This is basically the equivalent of a blueprint for electronic resources that you will find on the web. Almost everything that you interact with on the web is going to have a database connected to it on the back end that you never see. The thing that most people are used to working with are these visual, graphical interfaces, they call them. So like Facebook, you're used to seeing all the little poke buttons and you're seeing all the text flow by in the script there. Those are all being stored on a database and being called back to this interface that you look at, and they organize this data just like this blueprint right here. So this is a blueprint for the Thinkit verb theme. And for the language learners that don't have a first-born speaker to learn from, this is probably the best place to go for us to start to get a handle on how verbs work and how they conjugate. This provides a universal place, a universal way to look at that data. And we can do this with other resources. We could do it with video resources. We could do it with posters that have information on them. We can do it with nouns. We can do it with audio resources. All of these things can have an architecture built around them that will be universally accessible to other applications. So that was the first part of it, and that was a combination of a lot of work. We have Zaowish's Thinkit Verb Handbook, Thinkit Verb Structure Handbook. Clunet's developed a couple resources, Beginning Thinkit, Intermediate Thinkit, and Hausenech. And Kagi Shavu has done the 575 plus word dissertation that includes a website built around it that shows these paradigms around the language. And her dissertation explains how verbs will conjugate over certain modes. So altogether, that resource is probably, the meat of it about the explanation of the directions to do this stuff is, I would say, over 1,600 pages of information or thereabouts. So a lot of info to go over. The first time I read Kagi Shavu's dissertation, I have to admit, I fell asleep every few pages I had to go back and read it. Mm-hmm. Ever so often, you know, just backtrack because I found myself kind of wandering. And it's over that time that I started to get a grasp of how this stuff is organized and how you can organize it electronically. So from here, I was able to develop a database. It's the architecture that stands behind this database. And what I did is basically created tables that have these database or the language components built around an organization that's specific to the themes. So here I have a classifier table, and it shows what portion of its I component has. So this one has a negative I component, and what portion of its D component has. It's got a negative D component, and then it belongs to a classifier group. So you can see how difficult that can be for a learner. In order to really use this classifier effectively, you either have to have these precious, you know, invaluable resources that we have available to you to speak all the time, or you have to know that this classifier belongs to this I component, this D component, and this classifier group, and how that applies to the verb form where this becomes important. A lot of stuff to remember, but now it's all in a table for you. You don't have to try to think about this multidimensional array, basically. What I found in the, Kageshawa's work and Hune's work is each one of the themes is based around, each one of the classifiers is based around what I call a classifier theme. So each one of the classifiers, we have 16 of them, they go into groups of two to the classifier theme. So, for instance, there is a zero marker theme, and within that theme, you're going to have a minus I and a plus I for any given specific definition of a verb. Knowing that, I built a classifier theme that basically marries up to this table I call classifier pairs table. And now you can see how there's a classifier theme name that's associated to two classifier names. What that'll do later is when I build rules around conjugating the verb around modes, it'll allow users to see very easily from the plus I minus form as a close classifier and picks directly from a list versus having to think about which one goes where. It'll just throw it where it's supposed to go. The next is the conjugation. We have four main conjugations, and we actually have an empty set conjugation. And that was one of the things that I learned during this project is there's ways in which they have been defining these sets of data, and then finding out new things about the data, and then redefining the sets of data. So you start to build something, you realize, wow, okay, well, I got to start all over again because I missed this little piece. And so positionals don't have a conjugation because positionals don't use forms for which a conjugation is necessary. So you have to kind of have a undefined conjugation prefix available. And then we have objects. And here we have the object name and object definition. And each one of these objects, linguistically speaking, is tied to a perspective, if you will. You have your first person singular, your first person plural, second person singular, second person plural, and so on. So all of those are utilized to define the object pronouns and the subject pronouns. And so each one of these has a perspective ID that's now tied to it. And utilizing database technology, I've created these things they call foreign key constraints, which basically makes it impossible for you to interact with the data without pulling other pieces of this data in. So you won't accidentally miss these little chunks of data. They'll just automatically come when you call it. So let's see, we have the pre-verb. The pre-verb's a work in the making. I found out during the time of entering actual verbs into this database after I made the structure that the pre-verb is a totally different complex beast. Because some of them are solid, that you can only use one type of pre-verb on it, And others are variable, and they're sometimes variable at the end piece that you use, and they're sometimes variable at the front piece that you can use. And once I can figure out a good solid structure for that, I'll start plugging them in that way so that people can utilize that structure to help them conjugate more of these verbs in a kind of an orderly fashion, if you will. And then we have our stem variation type. So right now, the themes that are in the dictionaries, they have about, well, they have five main types, and really three main types that they use all the time. They have this invariable form. They have a two-stem variation and a three-stem variation. And right now, if you look at a theme, it's got a little conjugation mark at the end of it. I'll try to pull one of them up really quick here in her dictionary so that you can see it. So right here you see that there's no tilde mark after that, and that means that this verb is invariable. And you kind of have to understand that about the language, that it's invariable. And then you can see this one here has got a tilde mark, and then it's got two high tone marks. Well, it's got a high tone mark on its vowel. So this means it's a two-stem variation variable. It'll vary it in two different ways as to the vowel. And then they'll have others that are, let's see if I can find one really quick. Here we go, this one. So this one is long and low, and it's got the variable tilde mark. That means that it variates, it has a three-stem variation. It'll variate three different ways over the various different verb modes. So can you remember all that based on the rule that they gave us to learn this from? Or I thought that it would be easier for me to see that the two-stem variation actually has a short and high and a long and high. That makes more sense to me. It might not make more sense to try to fit this thing in that all one line, but if you're just trying to learn about how stems variates over mode, wouldn't it be cool to be able to turn on something, the setting that said, okay, instead of looking at it this way, I want to look at it this way so I can see how this thing variates. So that's basically what the database does. It allows you to take a look to organize what they have so far and give different ways to look at the data. And this whole object model, that's basically what it's about. It's not about trying to make something just for me. It's about trying to make something that's universally accessible to everybody that develops so that we can, it's basically like putting an uncle in everybody's hand to learn how to build a fire. The next category is a thematic prefix. It also has a thematic category. Basically these categories describe how the thematic prefix will work. And then you have the verb type, which you have verb type name, verb type definition, verb type special char. And then all this compiles together into a theme. And now I've loaded the data utilizing all these, this architecture, each one of these themes into the database, and I have themes that you can work from. So what does that mean for development? Well, now, someone who's a web developer doesn't have to know all the rules specific to the language. They just can look at the architecture of the database and start to build tools for the language around the architecture of the database. So now web developers don't have to spend umpteen hours reading 1,600 pages worth of data to get basically where I've gotten over 3 or 4 years worth of time. So it's going to be, I'm planning on trying to push this towards the Alaska Native Knowledge Network and to make it universally available to everyone. What I did is basically created a simple website. It's nothing really fancy, but I'm using three different technologies to make the website work. A lot of them work like this. You have your HTML code, which kind of formats your page and makes it look pretty. And then you have some some type of scripting language that will talk to a database and deliver this information to you via the internet. And then you have the SQL Server database languages, and that's the language that houses this digital information onto some platform that you can access. So it's three different languages that are going on to make this thing happen the way it does. There's a lot of different things that I ran into, little problems that, you know, I made an analogy about how it would be, you know. It's when you build a fire here, it's most likely you're going to have people to build a fire with that speak the same language as you. So you can go, hey, you go get the small sticks, you go get the medium sticks, you go get the big sticks, and you go get the moss. Make sure it's dry. Right. But when we work with languages and work in a digital format, a lot of times you have four different, five different languages that you're working with to try to stand this thing up, and it's the equivalent of having a Spanish person to try to relate to over here, and a French person try to relate with over here, and a Filipino person relate over here, all talking these different languages, and you're trying to tell them to go get this stuff. You have to convert it. So, you know, when you're building some of these things, these letters and stuff don't always transfer over, so you have to figure out the right encoding to put them in, to make them do the high tones and stuff. It took a long time researching, trying to figure out what was happening. Basically, to make things efficient for web development, they try to use the smallest form of character sets they can use, which is Latin. But Latin doesn't hold the characters that we need to convey Klingit. And so you have to force the applications to all speak, this Klingit version of this digital language. And it's not, you know, because everybody uses English all the time, all this information is kind of obscure, so it's like buried deep somewhere. And it's not like it's a big mountain, it's like this little needle in a haystack you gotta go find and figure out. So now that I've basically stood the database up, I have built these web pages that can basically show and demonstrate how it can go into a web page and be easily accessible to you. Here, you know, I show that it's a category name, a real, thematic name, puh, thematic definition referring to space. You can either put all that information into the way you develop something to show, you know, develop some type of language app, or you could just utilize the puh to help you conjugate your verbs. But as the information is there, it helps you understand as you're developing how to make that stuff happen. Subject pronouns, the same thing. the next version of this, I'll try to go and work with Zaywish and some of the other linguists to get the glossing terms for each and every one of these components within each one of these tables so that you can automatically have a gloss that's associated to each one of the themes. So rather than have to figure that out on your own and flip back and forth through the pages, it'll just be there. And there's the classifiers and the classifier themes and the stem variations, conjugation prefixes, and the verb types. altogether, if I exclude the time of reading and researching the linguistic side of the language, I decided that I was going to try to present something here because I knew that this could be done about 4 weeks ago. Since then, I probably put about 150 hours in to this project. That being said, I probably spent 3 hours making this thing that you guys can see very easily, this web page. I just this evening, or the evening before and a little bit this morning, put it together. It was the actual architecture that took a very long time to build. And I believe that that's the way it would be for web developers. I would like us to try to think around these digital terms regarding the revitalization of our language. Because, at one point in time, PC computers IBM was like the people who really decided, hey, let's build a computer that can fit on a desktop. You know, not one that takes up a whole room. One that general people could use. And when they did that, they decided at the same time, let's make this architecture open source. Let's share it with everybody. And it's because they did that, that we now have personal computers everywhere. The architecture that they started is what all the computers use today, including your smartphones that you have. So I believe if we do the same thing with this architecture, we have the capability of basically providing a digital universal place to share the language and share the information about the language with everyone and allow all the developers to have a chance to easily develop tools and develop tools that are meaningful to their community and their language learners. So that's about the brunt of my presentation. I would like to give special thanks to my, first of all, my great-grandmother Louise. She and my grandmother Dora Jack Williams are the ones, you know, when I was little, when my uncles and my dad would come around them, they would instantly start slip into Tlingit and speak exclusively Tlingit. So a majority of what I've learned about the pronunciations and stuff came from that experience when I was real small. Those are my uncles. I'd also like to give special thanks to Kakwan Ish, Kakashlat, Yashkashlat, Kakwan Ish, Kashkarish, for all their information. And again, being able to hear the pronunciations, having a chance to record them. You know, that experience, I would like to say, was so important because in recording them and saying the words, I have this knowledge about the linguistic side, and I would hear them say something, and I would go, the person that, Kagishawu, who was the linguistic person writing down, she'd write something down and say she heard something, and I would say, it didn't quite sound like that to me. And she says, yeah, it's there. And I go, you know, it doesn't quite sound that way. And I go back and parse these sound clip files and listen to them over and over again, and you could hear it. You could really hear it. And then after doing that so often, I was able to start to hear the differences in first-born speakers' speech dictum, or, you know, the way in which that they speak. You can really start to hear it then. So if you are a first-born speaker, I'm really thankful for all the work and all the things that you give to our language and community, and would hope that everybody has a chance to record you maybe, and you know, be able to listen to those sound files over and over again. Because without those things, we're you know, it's going to be really hard for us to recreate this language from where we're at. Everything that I know now is owed to my elders, to my family members, and to these other researchers. So I'm very thankful for everything that you teach. So, are there any questions?
In doing all this study, are you able to speak just all of your fluently?
it's a catch-22 situation, because the more you do this, the more you have to read English, and the less time you get to speak with the language.
It seemed like you'd have to take a lot of time to learn this in order to learn one word or something. I'm a fluent speaker, so I'm just curious about this.
Well, you know, just today as I was coming here, I was like thinking to myself, man, your mind's so wrapped around these English terms, these English technical terms, I'm having a hard time conjugating in my mind. And usually I can at least speak simple stuff, but today I was having a hard time.
Well,
so
we're like surely probably born with the thinking language heard at home. There's so much, even in the books that we have, that there's lots missing yet. There's an awful lot missing yet.
Well, one of the other reasons I want to build this universal structure for storing the information is so that the people that are gathering it can have a centralized place to gather it, and it can be kind of centralized way of thinking about how to store it. Back 20 years ago, 30 years ago, there was kind of a transition in the way that we utilized the written form, the orthographies. And it's still, even though there's kind of a universal one that the linguists use, there's still lots of other people that like to use different orthographies, different ways to write it down. And that makes it hard for people to learn and to teach. When someone comes to me and asks me to help them write their name down, I'm really reluctant to say, this is the way you do it. In fact, I always start out, this is the way it sounds like to me. If you have an elder in your life and your family that says it's different in the way I write it down, then listen to them. And I'm always afraid to write it down, because there's been times that I've written it down and I've heard someone who heard that and just turn around and say, well, this is the way he said it. And I'm like, no, don't say that.
I think the difference in where we come from, we have a little different squid to our words.
Yeah, the regional dialect.
But still be the same.
Any other questions?
Oh. Okay. I don't have a question, but I have a comment. I'm Julie Kendall. I'm an Indian language teacher in Anchorage. And I do have a problem with the written language. It's a language that I heard all my life and spoke. And I heard this word every day, I think, in my life, and that's the word for no. In the language book, it's spelled T-L-E-I-X. T-L-E-I-K, yeah, with a K. T-L-E-I-K, take. All my life I heard it as clack. Somebody might correct me on that, but we don't have a vowel that allows us to write that, clack. So they spelled it wrong, I think. And I heard objections from my brother and Ken Austin and other people that could read the language. And I think we should get together and maybe compose something or agree on a different spelling.
That's. I'm really glad that you say that, because I've asked that question and I haven't got a clear answer. And I think it's because it variates, or because I've heard. I've heard our elders say it exactly the way we say it, and then the way we spell it doesn't convey that same sound. So, yeah.
So I always have trouble once the students learn to read. I have to keep correcting this to the way I know it, because the language I teach is oral, and when I hear it, I have to correct.
Sheesh. Anybody else have questions? Or
I'm just really excited about the idea of this project. I can see how it can be useful to our language as well. I didn't understand most of what you said up until you showed us what it's going to look like, and I was like, oh, okay. You're speaking some really intensely code stuff. You know, I'm an IT guy. I fix computers for a living, but you were talking And plus the linguist stuff too, right? I'm not a linguist. I'm studying three languages, but I have a hard time keeping straight vocatives and ergatives. So I appreciate the amount of work that goes into what you're doing, and the outcome is just, it's exciting.
Sheesh.
I appreciate the presentation.
Oh, good sheesh for your words. I was worried. I knew that it was going to be recorded. And, you know, was thinking that maybe I should just show the end product, but it was like, wow.
It was worth the build-up.
Sheesh, I really appreciate that.
Yeah, and I probably want to talk to you some more about it.
Okay. Sure. Yeah, I would really love to develop a methodology for developing databases around the languages so we can centralize stuff. UPIC has a lot of resources too, but they kind of have the same issue. It's all spread out, and only a few people know how to put it all together to make it mean something technically and stuff. So.
So one thing I'm wondering, I love it, especially the digital organization of the whole verb template or whatever it's called, every morpheme and slot to it, because that will help the people trying to understand the syntax.
Yeah.
So maybe this is something that you said the web developers would do, but how will this give me a conjugation I want to? Will it appear similar to how the 575 plus verbs does or something? How will this show me how to conjugate?
Well, so I had the big vision of incorporating into this project, and then as I started seeing the time come, I had to make some reductions in scope, you know, because I just saw how much it was going to take. But the same structure that was built around the theme is going to be built around the modes, and the rule sets that are associated to the modes will have definitions that will include ways in which to conjugate around each one of the classifiers. So what that'll mean is instead of you just having the third person singular form for the paradigm, you'll be able to generate every single form at will. And so that's the next thing, but it's probably going to take an equal amount of time to develop that architecture as it did this one.
What we'll be able to do is have a bitwood box, and you put in the verb root, and it comes out with the conjugation reaction. Yeah, that will be wonderful.
Yes.
And we don't even have to go look at the page and find it right there.
And one other thing, you should check out Heather Burge, just finished her master's thesis, about something like mode and aspect of Plinkett. It'll probably be on ProQuest or something, but it's got stuff that you'll want for this. And then James Crippen's dissertation, whenever it comes out, will probably be the Bible for every component and a gloss for that.
That'd be awesome.
But he's going to finish that like within a year, I think.
Within a year?
Yeah, so look at all that.
Cool. I will.
Gonna cheese.
Gonna cheese.